Thank you. Please be seated. Ms. Arias, please take the stand. Let's bring in the jury. Please be seated. The record will show the presence of the jury, the defendant, and all counsel. Ms. Arias, you are still under oath. Do you understand?
Yes.
Mr. Martinez, you may continue.
When you were 17 years old, you moved out of your parents' household and you moved in with Bobby Huatis, correct?
Yes.
And you and he began living at his grandmother's house, correct?
I believe it was his grandparents, but he called them his parents.
And this was in Montague, correct?
Yes.
And the address actually was 611 North 9th Street in Montague, California, in Montague, correct?
I don't remember the house number, but 9th Street is correct.
And part of what happened when you were living with him was that you and he became much closer, right?
We just continued our relationship.
Right, but it got to a point, though, that you felt something, right? That something was wrong.
Yes. Oh, yeah, that's right.
And you felt like something was wrong, and so it was something that was inside you, and so that for a period of time you kept it inside you, but there was a feeling that something was wrong involving your relationship with Mr. Huatis, right?
It was more than a feeling, but...
When you say it was more than a feeling, what are you talking about? Did you see something else, or what?
I saw and heard, yes.
And you saw, before you did anything, what did you see?
He used to talk on the phone a lot with a woman that he was friends with prior to our relationship, that he had been interested, said he was no longer interested, but their conversations were long, kind of a little over the line from what I think was appropriate for a boyfriend of mine.
So you had this sense that something was wrong. He was talking on the telephone to somebody that he previously knew before, correct?
Yes.
And this individual was in New Orleans, Louisiana, correct?
Yes.
And because the conversations took a long time, that was something that sort of gave a rise to you to feel that something was wrong, additionally, right?
That, and he had had a prior interest in her.
Okay, so he had a prior interest in her, and he was on the telephone, and you believed also that the subject matter that he was addressing on the telephone was something that was also inappropriate, right?
Somewhat, yes.
When you say somewhat, it means it wasn't. So what are you talking about? What is the subject matter? Don't tell me what he said. What subject matter did they discuss that you thought was inappropriate?
It was more, I don't remember specific subject matter, but it was the tone and the way he spoke to her and that kind of thing.
Okay, so now it wasn't the subject matter, it was just the tone that you're talking about, right?
No, it was subject matter. I just don't remember what specific subject matter.
And as a result of that, one of the things that happened is that you had a car, right?
Yes.
And you would drive him around occasionally, right?
All the time.
So you would drive him around then, right?
Yes.
And at some point, one day you were going to go to work, right?
Yes.
And when you were going to work, one of the things that happened was that you and he stopped at the library, right?
That's right.
And you stopped at the library so that he could go onto a computer there at the library and log on and look at whatever it is that he was going to look at, right?
Both of us, yes.
Well, did you get on that same computer with him?
Yes.
So at the same time that you're on there, you go onto that computer and you're looking at what's going on, right?
Yes, for one period of time, yes.
When you say long period of time, how long were you on there? That's a long period of time while you're at the library.
I didn't say long, I said one.
One period of time. Is that what you said?
Yes.
So are you saying it was just one time?
That day, yes.
So that day, as I understand what you're saying, is you go to the library with him, and he gets on the computer, and you're looking at this computer too.
We get on the computer together.
Okay, both of you are get on the computer. Do you use a code, a password, or how is it that it works?
There was no code necessary for the websites we were visiting at that moment.
So anybody can get on the computers there at the library without a password and get to somebody's, for example, Hotmail account, right?
I think there would be a password necessary for Hotmail, but I don't know. You could get on the computer without a password necessary or a login in Wairika in 1997 at that time, yes.
So
that was 98, excuse me.
So you, in order to log in, what you're saying is, you did or you didn't need a password to get onto the computer?
Did not need a password to get on the computer.
But you did need a password to get onto, for example, a specific Hotmail account, right?
That's right.
Or a Gmail account, if that was around, correct?
Yes, I would think. I don't know about Gmail.
Okay, but it was Hotmail back then, correct?
Yes.
And both of you went onto this computer, and he looked at whatever he was looking at, and you looked at whatever you were going to look at, and then you dropped him off at a friend's house, I think is what you said, right?
Well, there was one thing that happened in between that.
Pardon?
There was one thing that happened in between that.
I understand that you want to tell me about that, but you did drop him off at some point, right?
Yes.
And after you dropped him off, you were supposed to go to work, weren't you?
Yes.
That's what you told us on direct examination, right?
That's right.
And after you went to work, and you didn't tell us about anything that was in between there on direct examination, did you?
I don't know.
Do you have a problem with your memory? I mean, this was approximately no more than 2 weeks away.
I don't think I have a problem.
But you don't remember things that happened within 2 weeks, do you?
Sometimes yes, sometimes no.
And in this case, you don't, right?
I don't remember if I gave you the details.
So the answer is yes or no. Do you remember?
Remember what?
What are we talking about?
We're talking about the incident.
Right. And what specifically of the incident are we talking about?
I'm not sure.
So you're having trouble focusing on what's being asked of you today in addition to having memory problems?
Yes.
So when I asked you about what was going on involving Mr. Juarez, you had no problem at least understanding that we're talking about Mr. Juarez, right?
That's right.
And you had no problem understanding that we were talking about the time that you and he went to the library so that you could get onto the computer and look at the computer, right?
That's right.
And during that time, after you looked at the computer, you were going to go to work, right?
Yes.
And on the way to work, you dropped off Mr. Juarez, wherever it was that you dropped him off, right?
Yes.
And after you dropped him off, you, because of whatever reason, decided to go back to that computer, right?
That's right.
And what you're telling us is that when you went back to that computer, you hit backspace, right?
Yes.
That's what you told us on direct examination, right?
Yes.
And when you hit backspace, you were able to access Bobby's Hotmail account, right?
Yes.
Even though that's password protected, right?
Only if you log out.
So if you don't log out, you can get right back on, right?
As long as you're not logged out, yes.
And so in this particular case, the security there at this library is such that, or was such that, somebody, if they didn't log out, anybody could have come in and looked at what was going on, right?
Yes.
And in this case, that's what you're telling us what happened, right?
Yes, he did not log out.
Okay. And you didn't think of telling him to log out either, right?
By that point, I was on another computer.
Yes or no?
No.
And with regard to the portion of the Hotmail that you were obviously looking at the Hotmail account, the two of you together, right?
No.
Well, if you need a password to get into the Hotmail account, and you said that both of you were looking at this account,
I didn't say
didn't,
that.
Well, didn't you tell us that you and he went onto this computer together?
That's right.
And that you were there when he was looking at this computer, right?
Yes.
And you're also telling us that you need a password to look at the Hotmail account, right?
That's right.
So while you're sitting there, and while he puts the password in for his Hotmail account, he accesses or looks at his Hotmail account in front of you, right?
No.
Well, I thought you were sitting next to him.
I was at one point.
And now you're not sitting next to him when he's looking at his Hotmail account, right?
No, I went to my own computer to log into my email.
So the answer is no, you weren't sitting next to him when he was looking at his Hotmail account, right?
Yes.
And you went over to your another computer to look at this point, right?
Yes.
How long were the both of you there at the library?
I don't remember, but it wasn't too long.
And after that is when you dropped him off somewhere, right?
Yes, at his friend's house.
And that's when you had this idea to go back to look at his computer, right?
That's right.
And did you think of asking him what he was doing?
I did ask him.
And you weren't satisfied with his response, were you?
That's right.
You were suspicious, right?
Very.
And so you were, at that point, very direct about or focused about what you were going to do, right?
Yes.
You were going to go back to that account, to that library, to see what was in that computer, right?
Yes.
Even though that was not your account, right?
Yes.
You, in a sense, were snooping in somebody else's mail, weren't you?
I guess you could put it that way.
No, I want to know how you would put it.
I would put it.
Ma'am, is there any other way to put it other than that you were looking at things that were not yours to look at?
I would put it a different way.
You would put, it's not snooping then, even though that was not your account.
That's not how I would put it.
I know that's not how you would put it, but that's what you were doing, right?
It could be looked at that way.
Well, I'm asking how you would look at it. In other words, did you tell Bobby, hey, I'm going to go back and look at your account? You didn't do that, right?
No.
You didn't say to him, and then when I go back to look at this account, I'm going to look to see whether or not there are any letters between you and this woman, right?
No.
And in fact, you didn't tell him, and if I find something, I'm going to print those letters out, right?
I didn't know that.
Well, you didn't tell him that you any of that before you went there, did you?
No, I did not.
And you did all of this without his permission, right?
Yes.
And so you go back and you tell us that you hit the backspace button and you're then into his Hotmail account, right?
That's right.
So how much time passed between the time he was on there and the time that you came back?
Well, it's Wairika, so not much time. He wasn't far.
Give me a time. It may be, doesn't matter where you are. I just want to know how much time.
Between what and what again?
What are we talking about, ma'am?
We're talking about the incident.
Right? And we're talking about where you took him, right?
Yes.
And we're talking about you coming back, right?
Okay.
And we're also talking about the time that he logged in initially, right?
Okay.
And we're talking about how much time elapsed between the time he logged in and the time you came back and hit that backspace button.
I don't know.
Could it have been an hour?
No, it was not an hour. I almost had to be at work, like, right then.
What's that?
I had to be to work almost right then, so it was only a matter of minutes.
So you decided to, so it's only a matter of minutes. You're saying it was about 5 minutes then?
Objection. This characterizes her testimony.
Restate your question.
How many minutes?
I don't know. I wasn't timing it.
Did you, after that, did you go to work and say, hey, I'm not going to come into work? Or did you go back to the library?
At what point?
At the point that you decide to go back to the library.
I went to the library first before going to work.
I'm not asking you that. Did you notify work, ma'am, that you were going to be late?
Objection as to relevance.
I notified them that afterward I did. I didn't notify them that I'd be late. I notified them that I wasn't coming in that night.
Right. In other words, you didn't even have the courtesy to tell them that you weren't going to come in until after this computer issue was presented.
Sustained.
So you didn't tell them that you weren't going to go to work until after this computer incident, right?
Argumentative relevance. It restated the same question.
Overruled.
After the computer? Is that what you asked?
Yes.
Yes. I was too upset.
And how long did I ask you if you were upset, ma'am? Is that no?
No.
So did you then go to the computer and you started looking at it, right? You hit the backspace button, right?
Yes.
Did it take you directly to his correspondence?
Yes.
And you started reading things, right?
Yes.
What was the name of this woman?
I don't remember.
And you did print out some of the letters, right?
Yes.
And you believe that they were inappropriate, right?
Yes.
And they were inappropriate. They didn't have any, they weren't of a sexual nature, were they?
No.
They were just sort of friendly kind of letters, right?
They were beyond friendly.
Well, they weren't sexual though, right?
No.
And they didn't indicate that they had met recently or anything like that, right?
They had never met before.
And they had never had any sort of, I don't know, physical contact. The point is they hadn't met before, correct?
Not by that point.
They hadn't met before at the point that you are looking at these letters, right?
Yes, not by that point.
And you then, however, decided that there was a problem here, that he was cheating on you, right?
Yes.
And that sort of validated what you had been feeling, right?
Yes, very much.
And so you decided to do something about it right then and there, right?
Yes.
It didn't go into work, right?
I did not.
You did notify them that you were not going to go into work that day, though, is what you told us, right?
Yes, I did.
Where were you working?
I think I was working at the Purple Plum.
And then you went to where Mr. Juarez was, and you started to talk to him about these letters, right?
First I printed them, and then I went there with them.
You did go to talk to Mr. Juarez, correct?
Yes.
And you had these letters, and you confronted him with them, with the letters, right?
Yes.
Ma'am, in your personal life, not the professional life, but in your personal life, you're very direct when you feel that you've been aggrieved, aren't you?
Objection argumentative, Your Honor.
Overruled.
It depends on how comfortable I am with the person.
Well, you were comfortable enough to immediately confront Bobby, right?
Absolutely.
Because you had a relationship, right?
Yes.
You didn't waste any time going right to him and saying, look, I have these letters and they're a problem for me, right?
I didn't say that.
You didn't go to him with these letters?
I did, but I didn't say what you said.
Well, so you told him you were okay with the letters then, right?
I didn't say that either.
Well, you let him know that you had a problem with those letters, didn't you?
I didn't say anything. I handed them to him and cried, and he read them.
So you went in there, you gave him the letters, and you started to cry, right?
Yeah.
But that was after you had not gone into work, after you had sort of gone into his computer, his personal items, and then immediately, within minutes, because Ryrica is very small according to you, you were there confronting him, right?
I guess you could say confrontation.
No, I don't want you to guess on anything. You were there showing him these letters, whether you were saying a word or not, you were there, right?
Define showing. I just handed them to him.
Okay. Showing, giving somebody the letters, that doesn't mean showing to you?
They were folded up.
Giving somebody the letters doesn't mean showing them to that person?
It could.
It could? Well, you were there. If you gave him those letters, your intent was for him to look at them, right?
Yes.
So when you gave them to him, you showed him the letters, right?
He reviewed them.
Ma'am, did you show him the letters? Just give them to him.
Sustained.
After you gave him the letters, he began to read them, right?
Yes.
And you were standing there, right?
Yes.
And you did not waste, in other words, you immediately went to see him, right? There wasn't anything intervening other than going to work and letting them know that you were not going to come into work, right?
Actually, that's not right. I did go home and get all my things and move it out. Then I took it over.
So you were even more assertive than that. You were not going to put up with any of this. You put the stuff that you had at his house, and then you moved out, right?
Yes.
That's very assertive, isn't it? Even at the age of 17 or 18, isn't it?
Objection argumentative.
Sustained.
Well, you didn't waste any time at that tender age, did you?
No, I'd never been cheated on before.
Ma'am, did I ask you whether you'd been cheated on before?
No.
I'm asking you whether or not at that moment you made that decision and you moved out, right?
Yes.
Weren't going to put up with it, right?
No.
And then you went to talk to him about it, right?
Yes.
And then you guys broke up about it. Over it.
We actually didn't.
You stayed with him then, right?
Yes.
Even though you felt that you had been cheated on, you decided to stay, right?
After some talking,
I did. The answer is yes or no. Did you decide to stay?
Eventually, yes.
Eventually means that there was something that happened in between, and you're telling us that you talked about it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is that yes?
That's yes.
Where did you go when you with your stuff? Where did you actually spend the night that night after you took your stuff and put them in the car?
My grandmother's.
And how long did you stay there?
I don't remember. It wasn't too long.
Was it days? Was it hours?
Probably a few days.
So after a few days, you decided to get back with Bobby, right?
Yes.
And that was your decision, right?
To get back with him?
Yes. That was after talking to him, right?
Yes.
Whatever it was that he said, and whatever thoughts you were thinking, you felt comfortable enough to go back, right?
Yes.
Additionally, do you remember when we talked about Matthew McCartney?
Yes.
You sort of did the same thing with regard to him, didn't you?
In what way?
In the way that we're talking about.
You being found specific.
Okay. You had a feeling, do you remember, after looking at a photograph?
Yes.
And based on that feeling, you drove to Crater Lake, right?
No.
Where did you drive to?
But not based on the feeling.
Well, you saw a photograph with a letter B on it, right?
Yes.
And you believed that something was going on, right?
Not at that point.
Well, at some point, you did go to Crater Lake. What is it that you learned that that allowed you to go to Crater Lake?
Two of his coworkers told me that he was with a girl,
right,
named Bianca.
Answer the question.
Finish your response.
A couple came into my work and they told me that they wanted to tell me something, and it was about Bianca.
And so you saw the photograph, you heard this, and you immediately left work, right?
I went home early, yes.
But you immediately left work. Isn't that what I asked you?
No, I had to do some side work before I left.
All right. How much time elapsed between the time that you heard about this and the side work?
Probably 5 to 10 minutes.
And so then after 5 or 10 minutes, you left because you were going to go take care of this issue by speaking with Bianca, right?
First, I drove to Ashland.
Did I ask you where you went?
Yes.
No, I asked you whether or not you went to speak to Bianca. Did you go speak with her that day?
Yes.
Didn't you tell us that you drove an hour and a half?
I believe it was about that long.
And so you weren't going to put up with that either, were you?
Put up with what?
Well, what is it that we're talking about here?
Which part put up with?
Were you going to put up with what we just talked about? Are you having problems understanding again what's going on?
Sometimes, because you go in circles.
Well, I'm asking you, did you have any problem knowing that we were talking about Matthew McCartney?
No.
Did you have any problem that we were discussing Bianca?
No.
Did you have any problem after you told us that you were at work, right?
Did I have any problem?
Understanding that?
No.
Did you have any problem understanding that after 5 to 10 minutes you left, right?
That's right.
And then after 5 or 10 minutes, you went and drove an hour and a half to speak with Bianca, right?
No.
What did you do in between?
I drove about 15 miles south to my home in Ashland. Got out of my stinky work clothes and just threw on some jeans and t-shirt and hit the road.
So other than the stop at your house to change clothing, you did go straight to talk to Bianca, right?
Yes.
Because you, whenever you feel that something's not right, that's your personality, it appears, you are going to confront that person, right?
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily. Well, the two occasions that we know of with the two boyfriends, isn't that what you've done?
Yes.
And so, with regard to Mr. Alexander, sort of the same thing happened back in August of 2007, didn't it?
No, it was in June.
Pardon?
June.
Well, do you remember talking to us about an incident that happened in August of 2007 when you were looking inside and you saw him kissing a woman? Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah, that incident was August.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
And that you weren't happy with that incident, were you?
No.
And you thought you were being courted, right?
I was being courted.
And you felt that you were being wronged, right?
I wouldn't say wronged.
Well, you felt strong enough about it to then go confront him the next day, didn't you?
I don't even know if it was confrontation. It was very non-confrontational on my end.
You went to see him, right?
Yes.
You went to talk to him, right?
Yes.
You want to clear things up, right?
Yes, exactly.
You just have a problem with the word confrontation because you say you are not confrontational, right?
No, it's because I wasn't allowed to be confrontational with Travis.
Well, you're saying that right now that you're not allowed. How could he possibly control how you acted?
He had that control.
You're saying that he controlled you so much that when you were in his presence, you had no free will. That's what you're telling us, right?
That's not what I said.
Well, you could have left any time you were in his presence, couldn't you?
Yes.
You did have the opportunity to never go there if you didn't want to, right?
Yes.
In fact, you moved to Wairika when you wanted to, didn't you?
Not when I wanted to, but eventually.
Well, wait a minute. You said you were going to leave around March. You talked to him about leaving in March, and by April, you're gone, right?
Yes.
So that's leaving when you want, right?
No, I wanted to leave much earlier.
Well, you could have made arrangements to do that, right?
If I had the financial means, yes.
Well, you spoke with your mom about it, didn't you?
Eventually.
In your personal dealings, you don't waste any time, do you?
No, I'm a procrastinator.
Oh, so even though these examples indicate that you acted immediately, you believe that you procrastinate, right?
I didn't act immediately in August 2007.
Well, with regard to Mr. Juarez, you acted immediately, right?
Yes, I did.
With regard to Mr. McCartney, you acted immediately, right?
Yes.
And with regard to Mr. Brewer, you acted immediately too, right?
Regarding what?
What are we talking about here, ma'am?
Mr. Brewer never cheated on me, to my knowledge.
Well, I'm not asking you about cheating. I'm asking about you getting out of relationships. You did get out of that relationship almost immediately upon meeting Mr. Alexander, right?
No. I already had one foot out the door on that relationship.
But once you met Mr. Alexander, you got back home, and immediately that Thursday, you told Mr. Brewer that it was over, right?
Immediately, as in 4 days later?
Yes, immediately, as in 4 days later, right?
Yes.
So you got home on a Sunday, and by Thursday, he was on the outs, right?
No, he was in the same house.
No, by the outs, I mean he was no longer your boyfriend, right?
That's correct.
So when you decide something, you can do it if you want to, right?
Yes.
And in fact, with regard to, for example, with your mother, you feel you act the same way with her. If there's something about her that you don't like, you act immediately on it, don't you?
Yes.
And in fact, you were talking about moving. She assisted you or attempted to assist you in moving, right?
Yes.
She came out in May, right? I apologize. She came out in March, didn't she?
It was late March or early April.
Well, didn't she come out on Sunday, March 30th of 2008?
Sunday doesn't sound right.
Okay. But she came out in March, didn't she?
Yes. It might have been late March or early April.
And she came out, and when she came out, and she was acting in a way that you didn't like the way she acted, right?
During part of it, yes.
She was making stupid excuses, wasn't she?
Yes, about her flight.
Right. And she was also being negative, right?
Yes.
And because of that, you made sure that she went back, didn't you?
No, that was her decision.
So it was her decision after you indicated to her that she was making stupid excuses and that she was acting negative and you didn't need it around you, right?
Yes.
So in your personal life, ma'am, it appears from these examples that we've been talking about, if you feel something, just again, based on these examples, it looks like you are able to act upon them very quickly.
Depends on the individual.
Well, I'm saying in these examples that we've talked about, it appears that you've been able to act very quickly, right?
In those examples, yes.
And so there's an indication somehow that when we were talking about Mr. Burns also, that you acted quickly with regard to him too, right?
What do you mean by quickly?
Well, you and he are talking on the telephone, correct, at some point during the beginnings of your relationship, right?
Yes.
And then you and he are starting to text message each other, right?
Yes.
You almost very quickly decide to make plans to meet him, right?
After a few months.
Right. And then you then decide to drive out there, and you actually do go out to the West Jordan area, don't you?
Yes.
And on the very first date, first time that you've been alone, you very quickly are having some sort of sexual contact with him, right?
No, there was no sexual contact.
So you're saying that based on your being on top of him and kissing him, that is not sexual contact?
I was on top of him sleeping.
Pardon?
When I was on top of him, we were sleeping.
But you woke up and you kissed him, didn't you?
After I moved and he adjusted himself.
So you're saying he adjusted himself. You didn't help with any of the adjustments.
I assisted him, yes.
Right. And basically that means putting your hands on his buttock area, right?
No, it was his shoulders.
So that, additionally, with regard to Mr. Alexander, you broke up with him at the end of June of 2007, right?
Yes.
You were able to do that also, correct?
Yes.
And you did it because of what you believe were trust issues, right?
Yes.
Let's take a look at what you said about those trust issues. This is Exhibit 479. Before we leave the issue involving Mr. Juarez, you and he were sexual, correct?
Yes.
And in fact, you and Mr. Juarez engaged in anal intercourse, correct?
On two occasions.
So the answer is yes, you did, correct?
Yes, on two occasions.
Do you know somebody by the name of Richard Samuels?
Yes.
And he's an individual that has come out and is assisting in your defense, right?
That's right.
And with regard to him, you lied to him, didn't you?
Initially, I did.
No. When he asked you about this issue involving anal intercourse, you told him that the only person that you'd ever had anal intercourse with was Travis Alexander, right?
I told him on a regular basis, Travis only.
So what you're saying is that he got it wrong then, right?
Objection.
I'm not saying that.
Overruled.
So are you saying that you did tell Mr. Samuels that you had had anal intercourse with other men?
If it was asked of me, then yes, I would have told
him. So he had to ask you then, right? In order for you to provide that information.
I answered whatever questions he asked.
And if he indicates that you did not tell him that, then that would be you not being truthful to him, right?
Rephrase.
Were you untruthful with him about whether or not you had had anal intercourse with Bobby Juarez?
No.
It's your statement that you did tell him that on two occasions you had anal intercourse with Bobby Juarez, right?
That's not my statement.
Did you or didn't you tell him that you had had anal intercourse with Bobby Juarez?
Objection, ask and answer.
Overruled.
If it was discussed, I would have told
him. Ma'am, the answer is yes or no.
If it wasn't discussed, then I didn't tell him.
Judge, she's not responding to me.
Yes, she is, Judge.
Restate the question.
Yes or no, did you tell him that you had ever engaged in anal intercourse with Bobby Juarez?
I don't remember if it was discussed.
Again, do you have problems with your memory such that you can't remember things?
I don't consider that a problem, but there are things that I don't remember.
So you don't consider that a problem that there's a lot of things that you don't remember in this case?
In this case, that is sometimes problematic, yes.
And with regard to the act itself, and part of the reason I bring it up is that, do you remember in this chat that you had with Mr. Alexander, you discussed baby oil? Do you remember that?
Objection, what act is he referring to?
Sustained.
Ma'am, there was an audio conversation that was played that took place on May 10th of 2008. Do you remember that?
Yes.
And do you remember that during that act, this issue involving KY came up? Do you remember that?
Yes.
And do you remember that in it, you discussed how much better KY was than baby oil, right?
Yes.
And the reason that you were able to say that was because you had experience with baby oil involving Mr. Juarez, right?
I think so.
Well, we don't want you to think. Isn't it true that when you and Mr. Juarez engaged in anal intercourse, you used baby oil, right?
I don't remember that far back what kind of lubricant we used.
But you do remember the telephone conversation that you had with Mr. Alexander dated of May 10th of 2008, right?
Yes.
And in it you do discuss baby oil and KY, right?
Yes.
Let's take a look at Exhibit 479.
No objection.
I move for the admission of Exhibit 479.
479 is admitted.
During the relationship, I was very happy, you know, and it wasn't always perfect. Our relationship was by no means perfect, but just knowing him has taught me a lot.
Were you happy in your relationship with Travis?
Yes, I was. Yeah. During the relationship, I was very happy, you know, and it wasn't always perfect. Our relationship was by no means perfect. But just knowing him has taught me a lot.
Objection, Your Honor. Can we approach?
You may.
You do indicate that he's an amazing person, right?
Yes.
And part of what's been we've been told about in this particular proceeding is that you've been telling us nothing but negatives about him, correct?
That's all I was asked about. That's correct.
Well, the answer is yes, that's all you've been telling us about. But he is an individual that was somebody that you loved, correct?
Yes.
And according to you, he was an amazing person.
Yes.
Right? And with regard to this amazing person, one of the things that we know is that when you broke up because you believed that he was being unfaithful to you, right?
I knew he was.
All right, and you knew that he was being unfaithful because you did, when he was asleep, you went into his telephone, right?
Yes.
And you looked at what was on his telephone, right?
That's right.
And you really didn't have permission to do that, did you?
No, I didn't. Actually, I did. I'm sorry. I did.
Oh, while he was asleep, you had permission to go in there?
He had offered, here, look at my phone, and I said no.
So right before he went to sleep, he said to you, here, have my phone, look at it?
It wasn't right before he went to sleep.
Ma'am, right before he went to sleep, did he say to you, here, take a look at my phone?
No, not right before he went to sleep.
So you decided, though, to go and look at that phone, though, right?
Yes.
And when you looked at that phone, you believed that you saw some text messages that were inappropriate, right?
I did see text messages that were inappropriate.
That you believe are inappropriate, right?
They were inappropriate.
Right. And in fact, these text messages involved some individuals, some females, right?
I assume they were females. There were no names attached to the phone numbers.
All right. So it could have been guys, is that what you're saying?
Not likely, but I guess it's possible.
So you looked at these text messages, and according to you, the subject matter is what disturbed you, right?
Yes.
He was talking about meeting people, right?
Yes.
And in fact, what you told us was that one of the persons was married, right?
No, that was his MySpace.
Okay, so that was something that occurred back at the time that you and he first started to date, right?
Prior to that. It occurred a few months prior.
But the messages, what did they say? I'm not saying specifically, but what was the subject matter?
Things referencing specific sexual body parts, interacting with other sexual body parts, things like that, and plans in the making of meeting up at hotel rooms or his house, things like that.
And you were very offended by that, right?
Yeah, offended would be accurate.
Right? And you were so offended that you still decided to go on vacation with him, though, right?
That wasn't why.
Well, no, you were very offended. You just told us that, right?
I didn't say very, but yes.
Okay, you were offended, right?
I was hurt.
Ma'am, didn't you just say you were offended?
Offended would be accurate.
And didn't you just say it was a good word, right?
Yeah, there's many descriptors to use.
But you just said just now it was a good word, right?
Yes, I think.
You think? It means you don't remember what you just said?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know? You just said offended was a good word, and when I used it, then you took issue with it. Is it a good word, or is it not a good word?
It depends on how you used it.
Well, I'm saying you're the one that I asked you the question that you were offended, and you said offended is a good word, right? That's what you said, right?
I think so, yes.
So, well, you think so means you don't know, right?
I don't know.
Well, this just happened. How is it that you are not remembering what you're saying?
Because you're making my brain scramble.
I'm, again, making your brain scramble. So in this particular case, the problem is not you. It's the questions being posed by the prosecutor, right?
No, not
yes
the
or
questions.
No. Yes or no?
I was saying no when you interrupted me.
So no, so in this case, you're looking to point the finger at somebody else again, right?
No, it's my fault.
Well, you're saying it's the prosecutor that's asking you the questions, and that's creating a problem for you, right?
That's not what I said.
Well, you said it's the way you're posing the questions. You just said that, right?
I don't know.
You don't know what you just said, ma'am?
Objection argumentative, Your Honor.
I don't know.
Didn't it just happen?
Yes.
So how is it that if it just happened, you can't even remember what you just said?
I think I'm more focused on your posture and your tone and your anger, so it's hard to process the question.
So the answer is, it's again the prosecutor's fault because you perceive him to be angry, right?
It's not your fault.
Well, is somebody asking you whose fault it is?
You did.
Well, you seem to be pointing it at the prosecutor, right? So you believe the reason that you can't be effective on the witness stand is because somebody is asking you questions in a way you don't like.
I think that was a compound question.
Ma'am, isn't it true that you are having problems up on the witness stand, according to you, because of the way the prosecutor is asking the questions, right?
Yes.
And so according to you, the truth with regard to this issue depends on the style that's being used, right? That's what the truth knows.
Objection argumentative mischaracterizes her testimony.
Same rephrase.
You're saying that you are having trouble telling us, you're telling us the truth from the witness stand, right?
Absolutely.
You're telling us that you're having trouble telling us the truth because of the way the questions are being posed, right?
Objection mischaracterizes her testimony.
Overruled, you may.
I have no problem telling the truth.
I'm not asking you if you have a problem telling the truth, but what you seem to be telling us now is that you have problems telling us the truth now because of the way the questions are being phrased, right?
That's not right.
So it's something else, then, that the prosecutor is doing that's bothering you, right?
I don't know how to answer that.
Well, it's something else that the prosecutor is doing that's stopping you from telling us the truth, right?
I don't know how to answer that.
Why don't you know how to answer that? You're the one that brought it up. You're the one that pointed the finger at the prosecutor, right?
Objection, are you badgering?
Ma'am, you're the one that complained about the way the questions were being posed by the prosecutor just now, didn't you?
Yes.
And you indicated that the prosecutor's posture was aggressive, right?
I didn't say aggressive.
You indicated posture, though, right?
Yes.
And there was something with the prosecutor's posture that you have problems with, right?
I don't know.
Well, no, you're the one that's used the word posture, ma'am. You're the one that said that you have problems with the posture. So is it the posture?
It's not the problem with your posture, it's that it creates a problem with me processing what you're saying, because I'm focused more on your posture than the content of your question.
So you're saying that you need to take some more time between questions to answer them? Is that what you're saying?
Sometimes.
Well, no. Is that what's going to help your memory to take more time between the questions?
Sometimes.
What's your answer?
Sometimes.
Ma'am, with regard to this issue of posturing, do you remember back on July 15th of 2008 when Detective Flores interviewed you? Do you remember that?
Yes.
And he was sitting down, right?
Yes.
And his voice was very quiet, right?
Yes.
And when he was asking you these questions and his voice was very quiet, you still lied to him, didn't you?
Yes.
So it isn't have anything to do with the volume of the question then, does it? As to whether or not you'll tell the truth.
I'll always tell the truth.
Well, oh, so you'll always tell the truth. So you told the truth to Detective Flores back then, right?
I mean here under oath.
No, you said I always will tell the truth, right?
I said I will always tell the truth.
Right. Did you tell the truth? Isn't it true you did not tell the truth to Detective Flores?
That's true.
Okay. And he had posture or a demeanor where he was just sitting back, right?
He was leaning forward, but he was...
All right, he was sitting down, right?
Yes.
He wasn't standing, right?
Not for most of the interview.
No, he wasn't, was he? And the reason you're having problems now, is it because the prosecutor's standing?
It's my own internal mental problem, I think.
Well, if it's your own internal mental problem, that means that what you are telling us are inaccurate answers, right?
Objection.
No.
She said she had trouble recalling not telling the truth. This mischaracterized her testimony, and it's continued badgering.
Sustained as to the first objection, rephrase.
Here, are you having trouble because the prosecutor is standing?
Having trouble what?
What are we talking about here?
You're talking about the truth. I'm talking about memory.
Aren't we talking about answering the questions?
You keep saying truth. I'm referring to memory.
Aren't we, though, basically talking about you answering the questions?
Both regarding answering questions.
Right. Isn't that what we're talking about?
You keep mentioning truth. I'm not having a problem telling the truth.
All right. But you are having problems answering my questions, right?
I don't have a problem answering your question if I remember the answer.
So, but you just told us that you're having problems answering the question because of the prosecutor's posture. Didn't you tell us that?
That's not the direct reason, but that's a trigger.
Well, that's what you told us just now, right?
Something to that effect.
Right. And so, would you like it if I stood over here like your counsel was asking you the questions? Would that make you feel more comfortable?
Your Honor, improper comment on counsel.
Sustained, rephrase.
Would it make you feel more comfortable if I stood over here and used the lectern, ma'am?
Why don't we approach again before he does the same thing over and over again, Judge?
Mr. Nurmi, are you asking to approach the bench with an objection? You may approach. You may proceed.
Would you be more comfortable if I stood here?
No.
Would you be more comfortable if I stood back here?
Where you stand won't make a difference to my comfort.
So, What you're saying is that you are hampered in your ability to answer the questions irrespective of where the prosecutor is, correct?
At times, yes.
Well, that's not how you phrased it initially. You're saying that you are having problems answering the questions because of the prosecutor's posture, right?
In that moment, that was correct.
So it changes from moment to moment then?
Sometimes, yeah.
So in this case, it changes from moment to moment depending on what the prosecutor is doing, right?
It's not necessarily just dependent upon the prosecutor.
With regard to your conversation with Detective Flores back on July 16th of 2008, he was pretty much sitting down in a chair back then, wasn't he?
Yes.
And yet you lied to him then, right?
Yes.
So it really doesn't have to do anything with the posture or where the person is sitting in terms of whether or not you'll lie, right?
Again, objection, we're not. That mischaracterizes her testimony. She said over and over again it deals with memory, not telling the truth.
Objection noted, overruled. You may answer the question.
What was the question?
Mike, could you please read it to her?
Question. So it really doesn't have anything to do with the posture or where the person is sitting in terms of whether you'll lie.
Well, sometimes I lied to Travis based on his posture.
Objection, Judge. He's not responding to the question.
Wait another question.
So you understand we're not talking about right now about your relationship with Mr. Alexander. You understand that, correct?
I understand we got very off track, yes.
Pardon?
I understand we got very off track, the subject of my relationship.
I'm asking you whether or not you understand that this line of questioning right now is not about your relationship with Mr. Alexander. Do you understand that?
I answered yes.
And this is about your ability to answer questions in the courtroom, right?
Yes.
And what we're trying to determine is what is it that will allow you to answer the questions from the witness stand, from the prosecutor.
I thought you had said whether or not it's the truth. It's not about.
Ma'am.
Which part are you talking about?
Ma'am, Mike, could you please read the further question again?
You're trying to do it to determine also what it is that will allow you to answer the question from the witness stand from the prosecutor.
I don't understand that question.
Question's nonsensical.
Restate the question.
Ma'am, you understand that we want your answers, whatever they may be. You understand that, right?
Yes.
And you understand that we need as complete answers as possible. You understand that, right?
No, that's not the impression I'm getting from you.
So the question is, so to you, unless you're allowed to ramble on, then you're being restricted, right?
No, that's not correct.
Well, in this particular case, you're saying that the prosecutor is cutting you off, right?
In this particular case, as in this cross-examination, yes.
And you're saying that you're not getting a chance to answer the questions fully, right?
That's right.
Well, let's do this. With regard to you and Mr. Alexander, one of the things that happened was that you and he broke up. You understand that back on June 29th of 2007. You understand that?
Yes.
The person that did the breaking up was you, right?
Yes.
And the reason that you broke up with him is because you snooped into his telephone, right?
Yes.
And you did not have his permission on the day that you did it to go into his telephone, right?
Not explicitly, no.
When you say not explicitly, it means that you did have his permission to go into the phone. You understand what you're saying, that, right?
Yes, at one point I did.
I'm not asking at one point. I'm asking on the day that you did it, did you have his permission, whether written or oral, to go into his telephone and look at his text messages?
He has told me to look in his phone.
That
so
day
I guess
before,
it's just a matter of interpretation.
Ma'am, that day before he went to sleep, did he tell you to look into, that it was okay to look into his telephone?
Not that day.
And so you took it upon yourself to look into that telephone, right?
Yes.
And that's when you saw these text messages, right?
Yes.
And then that upset you, right?
Yes.
And as a result of that, you made a decision that the relationship was over, right?
Not right that day.
At some point, you did make the decision that the relationship was over, right?
Yes.
But you were upset that he was having these conversations about bodily parts with these other individuals via text message, right?
Yes.
And you were so upset that you still decided to go on vacation with him, right?
That's not why.
Well, you still went on vacation with him even though you had this information, right?
Yes.
And you went to New York, correct?
We did go to New York, yes.
Pardon?
Yes, we did. Went to New York.
And then you drove, or you went to a PPL conference also, right?
No, it was a retreat.
And then you went to Huntington Beach, right?
That was the retreat I was referring to.
Okay, so you went to Huntington Beach after that, right?
Yes.
And you stayed with him, right?
Yes.
You engaged in sexual contact with him, right?
Yes.
Even though you were very upset with what you knew, right?
Yes.
You chose to go on vacation rather than break up with him at that point, right?
Yes.
And so the way you see it, it's his fault that you broke up, not yours.
Objection, mischaracterizes
testimony. Overruled, to me, answer.
His fault that I broke up with him?
Yes, not your fault.
Well, it was my choice, so I don't know what you mean by fault.
Well, we're talking about who was to blame. That's what fault means, right?
For the breakup?
For the breakup, that's what we're talking about, right?
I guess we each had a part in it.
Well, no, you're saying that it was his fault because he was doing these things with other women, right?
His fault for the breakup because he was doing things?
The way you explained it to me, ma'am, the reason you broke up was because of something he did, right?
That's what motivated me to break up with him.
So, what you did, the fact that you went behind his back and looked at his telephone, had nothing to do with the breakup, right?
That was also one of the reasons.
So, you believe that you were to blame for going behind his back, right?
Yes.
That was a dishonest thing to do, right?
Yes, I felt very bad about it.
Did I ask you whether you felt bad about it?
No.
You know, you say that you feel bad about it, but haven't you done similar stuff in the past?
Yes.
I mean, you did it to Bobby Juarez, right? You
yes.
went behind his back and you got on the computer, right?
Yes.
You went behind Matt McCartney's back and you went and talked to Bianca, right?
I didn't go behind his back.
Oh, you told them that you were going to talk to Bianca before you went to talk to her?
I would have.
The answer is, ma'am, the question is, did you talk to him before you went to talk to Bianca?
No, he wasn't available.
Ma'am, did you talk to him before you went to talk to Bianca?
No, he wasn't available.
Ma'am, you said he wasn't available. Could you have waited until he was available to talk to him to see if it was okay to talk to Bianca? You could have.
Yeah, but it would have been miserable for several days.
Oh, so it's all about you then, right?
Objection, argumentative.
Mistake.
You could have waited though, right? But you didn't want to.
I chose not to.
That's right, because you would have been miserable, right?
Yes.
And you didn't want to be miserable, right?
That's right.
And so this dishonesty that you said involved Mr. Alexander, you had at least on two previous occasions engaged in the same sort of dishonesty, right?
Yes.
And with regard to
I take that back. I don't think it was dishonest to go talk to Bianca, so I guess one time, because I do believe that the emails with Bobby was dishonest.
All right. But you did engage in conduct with regard to Mr. McCartney that he did not know about before you did it, right?
With regard to his conduct that I didn't know about?
No. I'm asking, the fact that you went to see Bianca, isn't it true that Mr. McCartney did not know about it before you went to talk to her, right?
That's right.
So that was behind his back, wasn't it?
No, because that implies sneaking around.
That was because why?
To me, that implies sneaking around, and I wasn't doing that. I was just open and direct about it.
You weren't sneaking around. You just didn't tell him about it, right? That's the distinction that you're trying to draw here.
Only because he wasn't available.
But that's the distinction that you're drawing here, is that you were not sneaking around, right?
I wasn't sneaking around.
Overruled.
Right?
Yes, it was not dishonest.
With regard to Mr. Alexander, looking at his telephone viewing his text messages wasn't the only time that you actually went to look at one of his communication mediums, right?
Yes.
In fact, you and he became an item in February of 2007, right?
Yes.
And you guys, that's when you made it official. You were still living in Palm Desert, right?
Yes.
And you were living in Palm Desert, but at some point you were able to look at his computer, right?
Yes.
And you looked at his computer at his house in Mesa, right?
Yes.
And you looked at his computer and you started to look at some of the items, what, in MySpace? Is that what it was?
Yes, his MySpace emails.
Pardon?
His MySpace emails.
But it was in MySpace, right?
Yes.
And you looked at some of the emails that were there, right?
Yes, I did.
And even though you didn't have permission to look at those emails, did you?
I don't know. It was kind of a trade-off because he did it to me, so.
I'm not asking if he did it to you, am I?
No.
I'm asking if you had permission to go into his MySpace to look at his emails.
No, I guess I didn't.
And so again, this is this conduct, this dishonest conduct on your part, right?
Yes.
And you went and you looked at his emails and you saw some emails between him and at least two females, right?
Yes.
One of them involved the New Year's Eve meeting, right?
Yes.
And that upset you though, right?
Not really.
Well, it didn't make you happy, right?
It didn't thrill me.
Pardon?
It didn't thrill me.
So if it didn't thrill you, that's a way of saying it didn't make you happy, right?
That's right.
But that happened before you and he were actually officially dating, right?
Yes.
And so that really shouldn't have had any bearing on how you felt. Would you agree?
That wasn't the part that bothered me.
I understand that. Tell me, what is the part that bothered you?
He lied about what it was about.
He lied to you what it was about after you confronted him, right?
No, he called me preemptively to explain.
Ma'am, you looked at his MySpace email, right?
Yes.
Then you and he had a conversation about it, right?
Yes.
So it wasn't that he had a conversation about it before you looked at his MySpace email, right?
About the messages? Yes, we did.
So he talked to you about them before?
Yes.
If he talked to you about them before, then why were you upset?
Because I found out that what he said was false.
Oh, I see. So he lied to you then, right?
About the message.
And what you were doing is you were sort of checking up on him, right?
Yeah, I was.
And that's because you wanted to see whether or not he was cheating on you, right?
No, it wouldn't have been cheating in December because we weren't together yet. I wanted to see whether it was accurate, what he told
me. Okay, so anything that he would tell you, you would want to check to make sure that he's being truthful to you, right?
That's not right, not anything.
Well, things having to do with relationships involving other women, right?
Sometimes.
in this case, that's what you did, right?
This thing particularly, yes.
And this is the other one that involved the email that you were particularly offended by, right?
The other email?
Yes.
Yes.
And you were particularly offended because you said that the woman that was involved there was married, right?
Yes, she was married.
And what was the woman's name?
I don't want to destroy anyone's marriage.
So what was the woman's name?
Shannon Crabtree Peterson.
And so you believe she was married and you believe that they were doing something that they shouldn't have been doing, right?
She was married, and by LDS standards, what they were talking about was very inappropriate.
But all they were doing was talking, right?
They were joking about getting together for a sexual liaison.
They were joking about it, right?
I hope it was joking.
Well, didn't you just say that they were joking about it?
Objection calls for speculation
as to whether or not they were joking.
Overall, that wasn't the question. May I ask the question?
Well, he was joking about his wet dream with her.
Objection, Judge. I asked her whether, isn't it true that you said they were joking?
Isn't it true? I did say that, yes.
And so the reason you said that is because you believe it, right?
Because he told me later after I confronted him. At the time, I didn't know what to believe.
Ma'am, you believe it. That's why you said it, right?
When I sit here today, I believe it somewhat.
Right. And so you believe that they were joking about it, right?
At the time, I did not, but now I think, if what he told me can be believed, they were joking.
Ma'am, isn't it true that you just said that they were joking about it, right?
Yes.
And that's what you believe, right?
That's what I'd like to believe.
Well, you are testifying to the truth, right?
Yes.
And you said they were joking about it, right?
That's the third time you asked me that. The answer is yes.
And so, if they were joking about it, what is the problem?
By LDS standards, you're not supposed to have conversations of that kind of nature with someone else's spouse.
Okay, and that's because you are familiar with the code of conduct involving sexuality in the Mormon Church, right?
I am now, yes.
Well, no, you were familiar with it back in February of 2007 when you looked at his MySpace account, right?
Not all of it, but regarding spouses and their behaviors how to interact with people that are married, yes.
Ma'am, you were familiar enough with their code to pass judgment on what was going on, right?
Yes.
As it applies to the Mormon faith, right?
Yes.
And this is knowledge that you had gained as part of your learning about the Mormon Church, right?
Another Mormon had explained it to me, so yes.
So yes, you did learn it, right?
Yes.
And so you knew that joking about these things was not something that was viewed favorably by the Mormon Church, right?
That's right.
But you believed that just joking about something, You knew about that. You knew that that's not something that was favored by the Mormon Church, right?
That's right.
But in terms of whether or not sexual intercourse is concerned, you're telling us that at that point, you didn't know if it was acceptable or not in the Mormon Church.
I'm not saying that.
So at that time, you did know then that sexual intimacy, whatever form they may be, was unacceptable in the Mormon Church, right?
I'm not saying that either.
Well, ma'am, did you know back in February of 2007 when you were making these judgments that having oral intercourse was against the teachings of the Mormon faith?
At that time, no, I did not know.
So you believe that just kidding about things is against the Mormon religion, but not oral intercourse? Is that what you're saying?
With a spouse who's married in the temple, yes.
So you're saying then that you believe that oral intercourse was okay back in February of 2007, but not kidding between two people. That was not okay.
Yes, that's what I was taught.
And don't they have brochures that they hand out?
Yes.
And these brochures include talking about sexual contact, right?
Yes.
You were here when Desiree Freeman testified, right?
Yes.
And one of the things that we know is that even laying or touching or laying on top of somebody with their clothes on, that's against the Mormon teachings, right?
That is right.
And in fact, that's something that you did with Ryan Burns. You laid on top of him with your clothes on, right?
Yes, I did.
And that's against the Mormon teachings, right?
It is.
And you knew that at the time you did that, right?
I did not.
So you gained this knowledge after being with Ryan Burns then, right?
After about a year after.
Right. So this is something that is, you never thought to talk to anybody about how far you could go?
I did. I talked to Rachel.
Well, I'm asking whether or not, well, Rachel is not somebody that's the end all in the Mormon church, right?
I don't think anybody would be.
Well, the bishop is a little bit more informed, wouldn't you agree?
Yes.
And if you had any questions about it, right, you could go talk to the bishop, right?
I guess technically, but I wouldn't be comfortable.
Well, you're saying technically, but you wouldn't be comfortable. You could go talk to the bishop, right?
Yes.
In fact, you went to Bishop Layton to talk about Travis Alexander's killing, right?
No.
Well, you called him, right?
Yes.
So you had no problem doing that, right?
That's right.
Did you ever have a desire on your own to go and find out what the Mormon church allowed in terms of sexual contact?
Yes.
Why didn't you do it?
I did.
Pardon?
I did.
So did you go to a bishop?
I went to Rachel.
When did you go see Rachel about this issue involving sexual contact?
It would have been August 2007 after Travis and I went all the way consensually and we were both awake.
So you went to see her in August of 2007. You converted in, or were baptized in November of 2006, right?
Yes.
And you and Mr. Alexander are engaged in sexual contact between that time, November of 2006, until what? April of 2000, or August of 2007? Is that when it is?
That whole time period.
And during that whole time period, it never occurred to you to try to find out what the Mormon church allowed?
I did try to find out.
Did you go to a bishop?
No, definitely not a bishop.
Did you try to read any of the literature that they have?
I'd read some literature, but not the pamphlet that you were reading from.
There is a pamphlet that they have, right?
Yes.
And this pamphlet is available to everybody, right?
Yes.
And in fact, you were here when I was looking at it, and I was questioning Desiree Freeman, right?
Yes.
And this pamphlet is free, right?
Yes.
And it lays out the guidelines for what is acceptable sexual contact and not, right?
Yes.
And isn't it true that that pamphlet doesn't include anything about joking involving married people, does it?
I haven't read the whole pamphlet, but the part that I read does not include that.
It does include things that you are not to engage in oral intercourse, right?
Yes.
And any kind of intercourse, right?
Yes. It says all sexual relations.
Right. And in fact, it even talks about certain types of music that shouldn't be listened to, right?
I don't recall that part, but that sounds right.
And it also talks about what kind of videos or what kind of movies should be looked at, right?
Yes.
And you're saying that throughout this whole time, from November of 2006 to August of 2007, you did not have the opportunity to review any of this and know any of that.
Well, I didn't know it existed, so I guess then I wouldn't have had the opportunity. But if I'd known it was there, then I would have had the opportunity.
Did you think that perhaps it would have been a good idea to go ask if these materials were available?
No, I did not.
Rephrase.
You were conflicted by the fact that you saw Mr. Alexander joking with somebody who you believed to be married, right?
She was married, yes.
You were conflicted because Mr. Alexander was joking with somebody that was married. Okay? Better?
Yes.
And although they were just, they had never had any sexual contact, right?
She doesn't know that or no.
Rephrase.
Even though you believe they had not had any sexual contact, right?
At that point, that was my belief.
Right. Yet, that's just people talking, yet you have no problems engaging in all this conduct that you've told us about during direct examination. You have no problem engaging in that conduct, yet you're judging somebody for just talking.
Objection, Ms. Kirkhurst, as a testimony, she's never said she had no problem with it.
State your question.
Well, ma'am, you never sought counseling from a Mormon, whether it's a male or a female, about your sexual contact with Mr. Alexander, right?
I did, but not during that time period.
During the time period that we're talking about, you did not solicit aid from anybody in the Mormon church about what was the proper way to proceed, right?
That's right.
And the reason you didn't was because it was enjoyable, right?
No, because I didn't believe I was in the wrong.
Well, you weren't enjoying what was going on with Mr. Alexander?
I did, but that's not why I didn't seek counsel.
And in fact, the way you described it was that he's somebody that you could not stay away from sexually, right?
Yes.
And he described you as his kryptonite, right?
Yes.
And so it was a situation that you were mutually attracted, right?
Yes.
So is the reason that you were being so judgmental is because you were just plain jealous? Is that what was going on?
No, I was considering a future with him, and if he was acting that way towards someone else's wife, I wondered how he would treat me as a wife.
So if you were worried about how he was going to treat you as a wife, then why didn't you just leave him?
Because I wanted to give him an opportunity to explain first.
And you gave him the opportunity to explain, and it sounds like you believed him, right?
Yes.
And so as a result of you believing him, you decided to continue in this sexual relationship, right?
Yes.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, the meeting is asked. Please be back in the designated area at 1:25. Please remember the admonition. You are excused. Have a nice lunch. The record will show the jury has left the courtroom. Ms. Arias, you may step down. Counsel, anything before lunch?
No.
During recess.